Good morning. This is Dr. Adel Bondok, Professor of Anatomy and Neuroscience, Mansoura University, Egypt. Today I will talk about the scalp. Okay, the scalp is a soft tissue covering the vault of the skull. It extends from the eyebrows anteriorly to the superior nuchal line and external occipital protuberance posteriorly, and from one superior temporal line to the other superior temporal line. The layers of the scalp read the word scalp: skin, connective tissue, aponeurotic layer, loose areolar connective tissue, and the pericranium or the periosteum. Then we'll talk about the muscle occipitofrontalis muscle. Then we'll talk about the blood supply, arterial and venous, nerve supply, and lymph drainage. Start by the layers of the scalp. Layers of the scalp is formed of 5 layers. The 5 layers are, okay, they read scalp. First layer is the skin. Second layer is the connective tissue layer, and this connective tissue layer is rich in blood supply, and the fibrous tissue is attached to the wall of the arteries. Therefore, when the scalp is cut, the dense connective tissue keeps the arteries open, causing severe bleeding, and it also leads to rapid healing. So the connective tissue layer is rich in blood supply. It contains also nerves and lymphatics, and injury of the scalp causes severe bleeding and rapid healing. The third layer is the aponeurotic layer, or epicranial aponeurosis. This one, epicranial aponeurosis, we'll talk about it in the next slide. And then loose areolar connective tissue. This loose areolar connective tissue facilitates movement of the scalp over the skull, and then pericranium, the periosteum of the skull. The first three layers are fused together, okay, and they move on the loose areolar connective tissue. Regarding epicranial aponeurosis, this is epicranial aponeurosis, epicranial aponeurosis here, epicranial aponeurosis. The attachment of the epicranial aponeurosis, it is attached anteriorly to the skin of the eyebrow through the frontal belly of the occipitofrontalis. Okay, so the epicranial aponeurosis attached anteriorly to the frontal belly of the occipitofrontalis, which is attached to the skin over the eyebrow. Posteriorly, it is attached, okay, so anteriorly, it is attached to the frontal belly of the occipitofrontalis. Posteriorly, it is attached to the occipital belly of the occipitofrontalis and to the superior nuchal line and external occipital protuberance. On each side, it is attached to the superior temporal line. Okay. So attached anteriorly to the frontal belly, attached posteriorly to the occipital belly, superior nuchal line and external occipital protuberance, and on each side to the superior temporal line. This is the superior temporal line. Therefore, the subaponeurotic space is closed posteriorly by attachment of the epicranial aponeurosis to the muscle and to the superior nuchal line and to the external occipital protuberance. It is closed on each side by the attachment to the superior temporal line, but anteriorly it is open into the upper eyelid because it is attached to the skin. So the subaponeurotic space, talk about the boundaries and surgical importance. These are the layers of the scalp. Okay, and this is the subaponeurotic layer between the aponeurosis and the pericranium. Between the aponeurosis and the pericranium. This subaponeurotic space is located between the epicranial aponeurosis and the periosteum. This space is open anteriorly into the upper eyelid. It is closed posteriorly by the attachment to the superior nuchal line and external occipital protuberance. It is closed on each side by the attachment to the superior temporal line. This subaponeurotic space may allow collection of any abnormal fluid like pus or blood. This collection will move anteriorly into the upper eyelid, causing black eye. That's why the subaponeurotic space is called the dangerous area of the scalp, because this space is continuous or is connected with the dural venous sinuses by emissary veins. The scalp muscle, the epicranial scalp muscle, occipitofrontalis. This is the occipitofrontalis muscle. This occipitofrontalis is formed of two frontal bellies and two occipital bellies. The frontal belly is attached anteriorly to the skin of the eyebrows, is attached posteriorly to the epicranial aponeurosis. The occipital belly is attached anteriorly to the epicranial aponeurosis and is attached posteriorly to the superior nuchal line. This epicranial aponeurosis is supplied by the facial nerve, the frontal belly by the temporal branch, the posterior belly, the occipital belly by the posterior auricular branch. And the action of the occipitofrontalis, this occipitofrontalis moves the scalp forward and backward, and the frontalis wrinkles the forehead and raises the eyebrow as act of surprise. Then regarding the arterial supply of the scalp is supplied by five arteries. Three arteries in front of the auricle and two arteries behind the auricle. The three arteries in front of the auricle are supratrochlear artery, supraorbital artery, and superficial temporal artery. The supratrochlear and the supraorbital arteries are branches from the ophthalmic artery, which is a branch from the internal carotid artery. The superficial temporal artery is a branch from the external carotid artery. Behind the auricle, two arteries, posterior auricular artery and occipital artery, and these arteries are branches from the external carotid artery. The posterior auricular runs above the posterior belly of the digastric, the occipital runs below the posterior belly of the digastric. Again, okay, supratrochlear and supraorbital branches from the ophthalmic artery or from the internal carotid artery. Therefore, the scalp is supplied by five arteries, two from the internal carotid artery, supratrochlear and the supraorbital, and they are branches from the ophthalmic branch of the internal carotid artery, and the three branches from the external carotid artery, superficial temporal artery running in front of the auricle, posterior auricular and occipital arteries running behind the auricle. Again, arteries, three arteries in front of the auricle and two arteries behind the auricle. In front of the auricle, this is the supratrochlear artery, supraorbital artery, and these two arteries are branches from the ophthalmic artery, which is a branch from the internal carotid artery. Therefore, the forehead is supplied by the internal carotid artery. This artery is the superficial temporal artery, branch from the external carotid artery. Behind the auricle, posterior auricular artery and occipital artery, and these two arteries are branches from the external carotid artery. These two arteries are related to the posterior belly of the digastric, the posterior auricular above, the occipital artery below. Regarding the venous drainage of the scalp, the veins correspond to the arteries. So we have five veins. The five veins, supratrochlear and supraorbital veins, سوبرا تروكلير سوبرا اوربيتال the two veins unite at the medial angle of the eye to form the anterior facial vein or just facial vein. Superficial temporal vein unites with the maxillary vein to form the posterior facial vein, and this posterior facial vein is also called retromandibular vein. This retromandibular vein inside the parotid gland divides into anterior branch and the posterior branch. The anterior branch unites with the anterior facial vein to form the common facial vein. This common facial vein opens into the internal jugular vein. The posterior branch of the retromandibular vein unites with the posterior auricular vein to form external jugular vein, which opens into the subclavian vein. Again, venous drainage of the scalp. Five veins correspond to the arteries: supratrochlear vein, supraorbital vein. The two veins unite at the medial angle of the eye to form anterior facial vein. Then superficial temporal vein enters the parotid gland, unites with the maxillary vein to form retromandibular vein or posterior facial vein. This retromandibular vein divides into anterior branch and posterior branch. The anterior branch unites with the anterior facial vein to form a common facial vein, which opens into the internal jugular vein. The posterior branch unites with the posterior auricular vein to form external jugular vein. This external jugular vein drains into the subclavian vein. The fifth one is the occipital veins drain into the suboccipital plexus of veins. Then the nerve supply of the scalp. The scalp is supplied by 10 nerves. 5 nerves in front of the ear and 5 nerves behind the ear. Each 5 formed of 1 motor and 4 sensory. Here, 1 motor and 4 sensory. The motor branch in front of the ear and behind the ear branches from the facial nerve. In front of the ear, the temporal branch. Behind the ear, it is the posterior auricular branch. The sensory nerves in front of the ear are branches from the trigeminal nerve. Supratrochlear nerve and the supraorbital nerve are branches from the ophthalmic nerve. Zygomaticotemporal nerve from the maxillary nerve, and the auriculotemporal nerve branch from the mandibular nerve. Behind the ear, branches from the cervical nerves. Great auricular nerve, C2 and C3, ventral rami. Lesser occipital nerve, C2, ventral ramus. Greater occipital, C2, dorsal ramus. And third occipital, C3, for which is a dorsal ramus 2. So two from the ventral rami, and the two from the dorsal rami. So two branches from the cervical plexus and the two branches from the dorsal rami of the cervical nerves. So the scalp is supplied by 10 nerves, 5 in front of the ear, 5 behind the ear, each 5, 4 sensory and 1 motor, 4 sensory and 1 motor. The motor branch from the facial nerve in front of the ear, it is the temporal branch. Behind the ear, it is the posterior auricular branch. In front of the ear, branches from the trigeminal nerve. Behind the ear, branches from the cervical nerves. So regarding the sensory nerve supply of the scalp, 4 sensory nerves anterior to the ear and 4 sensory nerves behind the ear. In front of the ear, supratrochlear nerve, supraorbital nerve, and supratrochlear and supraorbital are branches from the ophthalmic nerve. Then from the maxillary nerve, this is the zygomaticotemporal nerve, and from the mandibular nerve, this is the auriculotemporal nerve. So 4 sensory nerves in front of the ear, supratrochlear, supraorbital, belong to the ophthalmic, zygomaticotemporal from the maxillary, auriculotemporal from the mandibular. Behind the ear, two branches from the ventral rami of cervical nerves and two branches from the dorsal rami. The first one, this one, great auricular nerve, great auricular nerve, C2 and C3. This is the second one, lesser occipital nerve, C2, ventral ramus of C2, and then dorsal rami. This is the greater occipital from C2, dorsal ramus of C2, and this is the third occipital dorsal ramus of C3. So just the names of the sensory nerves in front of the ear, supratrochlear, supraorbital, zygomaticotemporal, and auriculotemporal nerves. Behind the ear, great auricular, lesser occipital, greater occipital, and the third occipital nerve. Regarding the lymph drainage of the scalp, the forehead drains into the submandibular lymph nodes. The lateral part of the scalp or the temporal region drains into the parotid or pre-auricular lymph nodes. The posterior part of the scalp drains into the mastoid and occipital lymph nodes. Again, lymph drainage of the scalp, forehead, submandibular lymph nodes, lateral part of the scalp, pre-auricular or parotid lymph nodes, posterior part of the scalp, mastoid or retroauricular lymph nodes, and occipital lymph nodes. And thank you very much, best wishes, and good luck. And please subscribe to my channel, like and share, and make a comment.